Yes, Ishika.
Namaste and greetings. I, Ishika Chaudhary, researcher at IMPRI, Impact and Policy Research Institute, Prabhav evam Niti Anusandhan Sansthan, Nai Delhi, extend my warm welcome to you all to IMPRI hashtag Web Policy Talk. Today, we have gathered for a panel discussion on the topic Caste Census, Why the Delay? As a part of the series, The State of Human Dignity and Development, hashtag Inclusive Development by IMPRI. Moderator for the session is Dr. Ajay Gundavarti, Associate Professor, Center for Political Studies, Jawaharlal Nehru University, New Delhi. We welcome you, sir. I feel very privileged to introduce the distinguished panelists. We have Professor Sujata Suripalli, renowned activist and head, Department of Sociology, Sathavahana University, Telangana. We welcome you, ma'am. Abdul Hafiz Gandhi, National Spokesperson, Samajwadi Party. We welcome you, sir. And Dr. Chandan Yadav, National Secretary and Spokesperson of Indian National Congress. We welcome you, sir. We all look forward to learning from the esteemed gathering. Now, I hand over the proceedings to the moderator of the session, Dr. Ajay Gundavarti, sir.
Okay, thank you, Ishita. And thanks to Arjun for organizing this very important and timely event on caste census. And this has been pending since quite a few years. You know, this discussion has been going on. And the latest round started with the OBC bill. And I think most of us here would have the consensus on census that there should be a caste census to kind of unravel who has benefited, which caste groups have kind of benefited in terms of both social wealth and in terms of opportunities. And it's not just about how much SC, ST and OBCs have, but this is also about the caste Hindus, the Brahmins, Baniyas and Rajputs, how much of wealth, what has been the wealth variation between these caste groups, and also to locate what has been the social process, social structure. And they're hoping that the census will really open up these questions with concrete data. As of now, we have only perceptions. We broadly know that caste Hindus have continued to hold on to their social and economic privileges, but we do not have any concrete data to actually refer to what in concrete terms that means. So we are hoping that this caste census would kind of open up and help in concrete policy making to benefit underprivileged social caste in India. But along with that, I would like to pose a few questions for the panelists and for the discussion in general that caste census obviously is not going to be like a magic wand that it will open up gates for all kinds of social transformation. It is going to come with its own set of problems, with its own set of new complexities for social policy and for society and politics in general. So few questions that I would really like to kind of to just flag off this discussion, you know, that the first question that, you know, that often is raised that in terms of concrete social wealth, we are aware that privatization, by and large, process of globalization, LPG, what we generally refer to it as LPG, has kind of unduly benefited caste Hindus. Many of the upper caste have moved to the private sector and others have left behind. So my first proposition that I'm kind of thinking aloud is that what does social justice here involve for Dalits and OBCs? That on one hand, we seem to be arguing that we need to oppose privatization as such. You know, there are groups like, I think Sujata is involved with the Right to Education movement, and the All India Right to Education Forum is in principle opposed to any private capital in education sector. They want education and health, at least two basic issues, to completely shift to public goods and complete state investment. But on the other hand, we are also demanding more reservations in the private sector. I think this is creating a block, a kind of a smoke screen for social justice parties, for those who are arguing for more reservations in the private sector. So will census really give us concrete political strategies of how to move forward? How do we do both these things, that we ask less privatization of health and education, yet we demand more reservations in private sector? Are these really canceling out each other, or can we imagine some strategy where we can think that both of these things can go together, especially with social justice and, you know, Dalit and OBC related political parties and social groups? My second question that really is at the top of everyone's mind is that on one hand, we also argue that the way forward for social justice is really to dilute caste identities, allow for caste mobility, allow for inter-caste mingling, so on and so forth. And this has been a general worry. Many post-colonial scholars, this has been part of Indian public discourse, that by through census were actually the beginning point of certain kind of a rigidity that caste, you know, Sudipto Kaviraj calls it from fuzzy to enumerated, that earlier caste was fuzzy, there was some mobility possible, some intermixing, but with enumeration through colonial state, through the colonial period, caste assumed a certain kind of a rigidity. So this, I think, again, raises a series of questions that will caste census, are we thinking in terms of caste census then fundamentally changing the anti-caste strategies? That is it not a real worry of some, that caste will now gain a certain kind of a rigidity, and therefore the stigma that these identities, because these are not, you know, fraternal identities, these are not identities that are merely in terms of difference, but these are really hierarchical identities where there is tremendous amount of stigma, social discrimination. So this kind of attribute, because Ambedkar himself did not want identity to solidify, he wanted mobility, but he was also looking at how to loosen up, fluid, make these identities fluid. So how do we then see this process, that with caste census, how do we address this question of anti-caste? How do we address this question of loosening up of caste-based practices? Because what we get to see with Dalit Bahujan politics is, as I said in the previous section, they're demanding more private the reservations in private sector. Similarly, when it comes to education, Sujata would know that at least in Andhra Pradesh and Telangana, there's a demand for English education, complete English education in public schools. But there's no demand from Dalit Bahujan politics in terms of common school system. So will we therefore, caste census, will they end up by offering us some kind of a knee-jerk, immediate, some kind of that look like solution, but in the long run, that might prove to be counterproductive to Dalit Bahujan interest. Third question is obviously the rise of Hindu right-wing politics, that what Hindutva kind of politics are today doing is at least to amount a fair amount of success. And Abdul Hafiz would know this, working in Uttar Pradesh closely, that a certain kind of a Hindu appeal cutting across caste has definitely grown and has met with some success. How do we think that this question of socio-economic backwardness that we are going to raise through caste census is going to impact the operation of Hindu identity? Because most Dalit Bahujans today, as I read the situation, seem to be seeing inclusion into the Hindu fold, and I often discuss this with Chandan, is seen as a mobility. Are we expecting that caste census is going to put a brake on this kind of a majoritarian Hindu consolidation? Or would it be fair to argue that caste census by itself may not put a brake on Hindu majoritarian consolidation? That's my third question. My fourth question is really seems to be very pertinent is that what is it going to do to intra-subaltern, intra-caste relations within subaltern caste, within Dalits and OBCs? Because this now caste, we know that, you know, Uttar Pradesh, BJP's experiment, the success of BJP's experiment primarily has been to wean away non-Jatav Dalit social groups and non-Yadav lower end OBCs. With caste census, not only will we be questioning caste Hindu consolidation or the power, social power and economic wealth that caste Hindus enjoy, but we will also have to, I think the data about, for instance, Yadavs gaining more in the context of Bihar and Uttar Pradesh as against other castes will also come out. Those that kind of a data might also come out. Or Malas in the context of Andhra Pradesh vis-a-vis other subcastes within Dalits also will come out. Jatavs in the context of UP. So how do we, now what do we think can be the possible fallout of this kind of a data? That this is also, will it not lead to what we're talking of a Bahujan unity? That in fact it might lead to a certain social stress. It might lead to growing intra-subaltern conflicts. Conflicts between OBC and Dalits might also, you know, go up with this kind of a data coming to the forefront. My last question obviously is the interrelation between caste and communalism. That what kind of an equation are we expecting? The general assumption in Indian politics by political scientists has been that more secular caste identity consolidation will lead to less communalism. My own hunch is that post-neoliberalism, I think growing identitarian politics, narrow identity views have not led to secular outcomes, but have only led to more. Why that should be, I think that's a very complex question. I'm not going to go into that, but that's there for all of us to kind of see that in some sense, narrow identity consolidation is also enabling both neoliberal kind of reform and also an anti-Muslim kind of sentiment. It has to do with masculinity, various other social factors. I don't think that's very relevant in the immediate sense. I mean, if some of you wish to go into those sociological details, you are most welcome to do it. But I think the overall anxiety is that this kind of narrow caste-based identity mobilization is somehow also contributing to a majoritarian communalism, targeting Muslims because of the anxieties, social wealth, and what Uttar Pradesh BJP has been doing following the kind of a policy of dispossession of Muslims. We have seen that in Muzaffarnagar, that scores of Muslims are being now displaced from their villages, you know, concentrated in some camps. And I don't know what RSS has in terms of long, the worst one can imagine. Therefore, one may have to also link this process of consensus. Because if you look at the census, it's very interesting what BJP is doing in the OBC bill, that they're only interested in the census of the OBCs. They're not interested in caste Hindu census. They're only going to tell us how much of which group in OBCs has. So there is an element of mischief that might come into play. So those are my preliminary things that I wanted to flag off in the 10 minutes allotted by Arjun. I now welcome Abdul Hafiz Gandhi to make his presentation in 15 minutes and tell us, I mean, he can cover. Over to you, Hafiz.
Thank you, Dr. Ajay Gutavardiji. And I would like to thank MPRI for giving me this opportunity to present my point of view. Now, I would like to start from the point that caste is a reality in Indian society. You cannot negate it. You accept it, you disapprove it, but you cannot negate it. So caste is, the reality. The other thing is that as far as my point of view is concerned, social justice is all about representation. Representation in various walks of life, whether it is public institutions, private sector, even judiciary. I count judiciary because judiciary should also have diverse point of view. And since we have collegium system, so that diversity is not there in the judiciary. So my point of view is that if you want justice, then there must be diversity of views. So until and unless there is diversity in views, justice cannot be ensured, whether it is social justice or whatever you call justice is. Now, if there is a problem, you need data for that, because without data, you cannot analyze the problem. So if you have a disease, in scientific terms, if you have a disease, then you need scientific data in order to analyze the disease, in order to provide the, you know, the medicines or the solution for that disease. So similarly, I look the caste census that if there is a problem in Indian society, then you need to have data for that. Now, as you know that privileges are, you know, differently enjoyed by different communities. So there are dominant communities, there are non-dominant communities in India. And still, because this is my hunch and this is my presumption, that most of the power positions and privileges, they are still enjoyed by the dominant caste. It is not, despite the fact that we have reservations since, you know, decades, the benefit of reservation has not reached the targeted section of the society. I don't know whether there is an institutional bias or we have not been able to, you know, effectively operationalize the reservation provisions in the constitution. I cannot say with exactness that what is the reason, but still we have not been able to give the benefit to the targeted section. And that is why we should know who in the society is enjoying privileges. And for that, you need to have data. Now, if you count OBC, because BJP in 2018 promised that they will, in 2021, they will carry out OBC count in the census. But now they are in an ambivalent situation, because when 11 member committee from Bihar met Prime Minister has not said anything. The delegation said everything to the Prime Minister. The Prime Minister has not said anything. But nationally, the BJP is ambivalent. But if you look at Bihar, the Bihar BJP is not opposing the caste census. I think they are in favor. So I say that if you count OBC, then that can, you know, record the discrimination aspect of the thing. But if you have the all caste census, then you come to know about the privilege aspect of it. So unless you come to know about the privilege aspect of it, there is no use of, counting OBC. Because if you count OBC, then you can count the discrimination aspect of it. But I want to know that who is enjoying what? Which section of the society is enjoying, how much privilege, how much positions they are having, and how much percentage of there is in the population. And my party is of the view that we believe in the slogan, jiski jitni hissedari, uski utni bhagedari. और ये कहीं ना कहीं डेमोक्रेटिक कंसेप्ट है, ये डेमोक्रेटिक है कि जिसकी जितनी पॉपुलेशन हो उसके हिसाब से होना चाहिए. एंड वी टू हैव कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल प्रोविजंस सपोर्टिंग माय पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू. इफ यू लुक आर्टिकल 16, देन द क्लॉजेस ऑफ आर्टिकल 16 से दैट देयर मस्ट बी एडुकेसी ऑफ सर्टेन सेक्शंस ऑफ द सोसाइटी इन पब्लिक इंस्टीट्यूशंस एज वेल एज एजुकेशनल इंस्टीट्यूशंस. सो एडुकेसी मस्ट बी देयर. एंड व्हेन आई से एडुकेशन, इट सीज दैट जिसकी जितनी संख्या भारी उसकी उतनी हिस्सेदारी. नाउ इफ यू लुक लीगली, देन सुप्रीम कोर्ट इज ऑफ द व्यू दैट फॉर इंक्लूजन एंड एक्सक्लूजन ऑफ कास्ट फ्रॉम द रिजर्वेशन सिस्टम यू नीड सॉलिड एविडेंस, सॉलिड डेटा. नाउ अनलेस यू हैव अ डेटा हाउ टू एक्सक्लूड एंड इंक्लूड, यू डोंट हैव ओबीसी डेटा बिकॉज यू आर रिलाइंग ऑन द डेटा विच वॉज कलेक्टेड इन 1931, बिकॉज 1931 वॉज द लास्ट कास्ट डेटा. सो Supreme Court say that you need, quantifiable data. You need solid evidence for including and excluding certain caste groups from taking the benefits of reservation. But how do you do it? You don't have the data to support the inclusion or the exclusion of certain communities. And I have not seen a country where you provide affirmative action and you do not count the social groups. So when you are having provisions in the constitution for providing affirmative action to certain sections of the society, you must count it. Why you are afraid of counting it? When you can conduct the caste census of STs and SCs, why not about OBCs? And why not about all the remaining upper castes? You can conduct that very easily. So here I would like to come to the two points. That there is still a debate going, as Dr. Ajay Godavardi pointed out, that party that is BJP, which is in power, is ready to count OBCs, but it is not ready to count the remaining section, which is the upper caste section of Indian society. Now, if you say that they are going to count the OBC section, then there is no operational difficulty in that, because you just need to add one single column of OBC in the census, because there is already the counting of STs and SCs, and you need to add only one column of OBC. And by adding only one column, you can count about 60 to 80% of the Indian population, because already you are counting STs and SCs. So by adding OBCs to one column of the OBC, you can count 60 to 80% of the Indian population. Now the remaining 20% of the population, you may say, now there is one practical aspect of it, that you may say that as far as OBC is concerned, there is no, the list, because list of OBC differs from state to state, then that may pose serious challenge as far as OBC count is concerned. Now here I have a solution to it, that if you want to count OBC, then there is a central list. Then you can have the central list for counting OBC population. But my point of view is that you should count every section of the society, because unless you count every section of the society, the privilege aspect of it would not come out. Discrimination aspect would come out with the counting of OBCs, but the privilege aspect will not come out. Because I was reading the state of Madras versus Champakam Durai Rajan, and there I came to know about that in that very particular area, the Brahmins, they were 3.2%, but they were enjoying the post till 70 to 80%. Public posts, the subdivisional magistrate, etc., judges, etc. And these figures are given in the Durai Rajan case. Now, you can have the discrimination aspect, but unless you count the all caste, you will not come to know about the privilege aspect of it. Now the problem is that we do not have the ready-made list of the general caste, how to count them. Now we can have the solution to this problem also, because if you look the Anthropological Survey of India's Ensol Cyclopedia survey, then they have a survey called People of India. Now by taking the help of the People of India survey, you can count the upper caste also. You can very easily count the upper caste. So the argument of those sections of the people who say that it's very difficult to count the upper caste people, I would say that they must refer to this People of India survey, and they would have, they can very easily count the sections from the upper caste. Now, I'm very much clear that caste census is required. Now the other aspect is why there is a delay in conducting caste census. As I say that now the BJP is now backtracking from its promise of 2018 when they said that they would count the OBC, but now they are also not ready as far as the OBC is concerned. They are in an ambivalent situation. Now there are certain political parties and pressure groups which are dominated by a particular class of people, and they don't want to come the truth to come out. And truth is that still the marginalized sections, they are not enjoying the benefits which they were promised. Now, Bihar Assembly in 2019 and 2020, they passed an unanimous resolution in favor of the caste census. Similar thing can be done by those parties which claim to represent the marginalized sections of the society. Why they can't do the same thing from the assemblies? When there was a CAA bill, CAA law, then certain assemblies passed resolutions against implementing CAA. When there were three farm laws implemented by the government of India, certain state assemblies, they passed resolution against implementing farm laws. Why the similar exercise is not conducted in favor of caste census from these different assemblies? When Bihar Assembly can do it, why other assemblies and other political parties who are at the helm of affairs in states or who represent the marginalized sections of society, they do the same thing? So my point of view is that we must not only conduct the OBC count, we must conduct the all caste count, because that is how you would be able to know that which section of the society is enjoying which privilege and which position and what power. Now, I would also say that it is not only about the count of the Hindu religion. I think this survey must be conducted, you know, cutting across religious lines. This survey must be conducted of the Muslim communities also, because there is a large section of the society called Pasmanda in Muslim communities. They also lag behind as far as their own development is concerned. There is also the cornering of benefit and privileges and power by certain section of the society in the Muslim community also. Now the same applies to the Christianity, Buddhism, Sikhs, Jain, Parsis, etc. Now there can be the argument that these religions do not have caste system. Then how to count them? But the reality is that religions may be egalitarian, but the followers are not, you know, following what principles are laid down in the religious scriptures. So religion may be egalitarian, but the caste system is there in every religion. Whether you say you take Christianity, you take Muslims, you take Sikhs, Jains, Parsis, etc., because caste system is there. So I would say that it should not be only about the count of the caste system in the Hindu religion, but this must be, you know, provided that the count should be from all religions. Now I'm returning back to the importance of counting caste. Why it is important? Now I would like to take you to 2019, when economically weaker section quota bill was passed in the parliament. Now within 3-4 days, this bill was cleared. On 8th January, it was introduced. It was passed by one house. The other day, it was passed by the other house. And by 12th January, it was published in the official gadget. So within 4-5 days, this EWS reservation, which was 103 constitutional amendment, was implemented across the country. No survey was conducted. Now, how come the government come to know that this particular section of the society is lagging behind in development indices? So no demand was there, because I have not seen any agitation in favor of the people that you must provide EWS. No protest, no street demonstration, but on a very fine morning, we come to know that there was a bill in the parliament. And the press also supported it. The press, who is dominated by a particular section, who is always opposed reservation, they did not say a single word against EWS reservation. They accepted it. They accepted it without any full stop or comma. Now, why I'm saying this? That Supreme Court again and again is saying that you need data. Now, where was the data when EWS reservation was introduced, and that through a constitutional amendment? And what sort of reservation? You put 8 lakh limit. Ceiling is 8 lakh. Now, 8 lakh comes to 66,000 rupees per month. Who is a poor who is earning 66,000 rupees a month? Can you categorize him as a poor? Now, this reservation is actually provided to the middle class of the upper caste. It is not EWS, economically weaker section. Economically weaker section, they does not earn 66,000 rupees a month. So this reservation is to the middle class of the economical, the upper caste, because bill specifically says that SCs, STs and OBCs are excluded from this reservation. Iska seedha matlab hai ki middle class jo bacha, usko ye reservation kehne ke liye chahega. Ab koi data nahi tha. Ab aap double standards dekhiye. When the OBC reservation was increased in Madhya Pradesh to 27%, this was stayed by the Madhya Pradesh High Court. But when this constitutional amendment, 103 constitutional amendment, was challenged in the Supreme Court, which also breached the 50% ceiling limit provided by Indira Sahni, and Supreme Court did not, you know, stay the implementation of EWS reservation. So whenever it comes to the question of providing reservation to OBC, the court will act. And I'm saying this with due respect to higher judiciary. We can criticize the judgment of this judiciary. I'm not imputing motives to any judge, but I'm saying that you have double standards as when you implement reservation provisions. Because Madhya Pradesh 27% reservation to OBCs, you will state. But when a bill which was not properly discussed in parliament, which was passed in 4 days, and about which there was no popular demand from the people, no demonstration, no public protest, etc., and you pass the bill and Supreme Court didn't state, and there was no data, and therefore I'm saying that if Supreme Court is saying that for exclusion and inclusion of OBC caste you need solid data, solid evidence, then I think that when we are demanding that all caste must be counted, I am saying that we are somewhere down the line obeying the Supreme Court judgments, which Supreme Court delivered from time to time. And here I would like to rest my case, and I would say that there must be all caste census conducted by the government of India. इससे जो कास्ट आइडेंटिटी है कहा जाता है कि इससे डिवीजन क्रिएट होगा, लेकिन हम रिलीजियस ग्राउंड पर सेंसस में काउंट करते हैं उससे तो डिवीजन पैदा नहीं होता. हम एसटीज को हम काउंट करते हैं उससे डिवीजन पैदा नहीं होता, लेकिन हम ओबीसी का अगर कर लेंगे, अगर हम और कास्ट का कर लेंगे तो डिवीजन हो जाए. और डेली हमारे मैट्रिमोनियल कॉलम्स भरे रहते हैं, और इसलिए कहा जाता है कि जो बीमारी पहले आई थी वो पहले जानी चाहिए. आई एम रिस्पॉन्डिंग टू डॉक्टर अजय गोडावर्दी साहब ने दैट कास्ट सिस्टम पहले आया था, कास्ट सिस्टम पहले जाना चाहिए, लेकिन इस कास्ट सिस्टम को हम बचा कर रखते हैं फ्रॉम द टाइम वी आर बॉर्न, और जो हमारी जो अपब्रिंगिंग होती है वो भी कहीं ना कहीं वो एक जो सोशल कैपिटल होता है उसके बेसिस पर होती है. हमको जो प्रिविलेजेस मिलते हैं वो सोशल कैपिटल के बेसिस पर मिलते हैं, जिस जगह हम पैदा होते हैं. इसलिए जो अम्बिलिकल कॉर्ड है ना, उससे बहुत सारे प्रिविलेजेस, पावर, पोजीशन, आपकी जो हायरार्की है, आपकी जो जो ऑनर एंड डिग्निटी आपको मिलेगा, वो जो आपकी अम्बिलिकल कॉर्ड है उससे कहीं ना कहीं जुड़ा. और मुझे लगता है कि जब तक कास्ट सिस्टम के खात्मे की हम बात नहीं करते हैं, एनिलेशन ऑफ कास्ट सिस्टम की हम बात नहीं करते हैं, तब तक जो उससे जुड़े बेनिफिट्स हैं मुझे लगता है कि वो चलते रहने चाहिए, क्योंकि हम कास्ट सिस्टम के खात्मे की कभी बात नहीं करते हैं. मैंने तो कोई प्रोटेस्ट आज तक नहीं देखा जहां पर एनिलेशन ऑफ कास्ट सिस्टम की बात की गई हो, बाय स्पेशली अपर कास्ट पीपल. बहुत बड़े प्रोटेस्ट मैंने नहीं देखे, और हम उनके जो नामों के नोमेनक्लेचर हैं उनसे भी हम समझ सकते हैं. हम ये मान सकते हैं कि बचपन में उनके नाम रख दिए गए होंगे, लेकिन जब 10वीं क्लास में वो गए होंगे, 12वीं क्लास में जो गए होंगे, बाद में भी आप एफिडेविट लगाकर चेंज कर सकते हैं, लेकिन हम चेंज नहीं करते, क्योंकि वो जो नाम जुड़ा हुआ है ना उससे हमारे प्रिविलेजेस डिसाइड होते हैं. हम माने ना माने, एजुकेशन इंस्टीट्यूशन में, नौकरियों में, पब्लिक इंस्टीट्यूशन में, इवन इन जुडिशियरी आई कैन काउंट मेनी केसेस जहां पर कहीं ना कहीं जो हमारे जजेस जाते हैं वो हमारे भीतर से ही जाते हैं, सोसाइटी से ही जाते हैं, और वो किस तरह से बात करते हैं. आप स्टेट ऑफ बॉम्बे वर्सेस नरसू अप्पा माली का केस देख लीजिए, जहां पर ये फैसला होना था कि वेदर पर्सनल लॉज दे आर लॉज विद इन द मीनिंग ऑफ आर्टिकल 13 और नॉट, एंड वेदर पर्सनल लॉज कॉन्ट्रडिक्ट फंडामेंटल राइट्स और नॉट, एंड इफ दे कॉन्ट्रडिक्ट फंडामेंटल राइट्स देन पर्सनल लॉ शुड बी स्ट्रक डाउन. लेकिन बॉम्बे हाईकोर्ट ने कहा, और उसमें बहुत प्रोग्रेसिव जज थे एम सी छागला, उन्होंने कहा नो, पर्सनल लॉज आर नॉट लॉज विद इन द मीनिंग ऑफ आर्टिकल 13. और हम जो पर्सनल लॉज में इनइक्वालिटीज हैं उनको उनमें हम इन्फ्यूज नहीं कर सकते मॉडर्न कंसेप्ट लाइक इक्वालिटी, लाइक डिग्निटी, एक्सेट्रा एंड एक्सेट्रा. सो दी बॉम्बे हाईकोर्ट रिफ्यूज, और उसी को सुप्रीम कोर्ट ने कई जजमेंट में जो है वो एक तरह से अपहेल्ड किया है. सुप्रीम कोर्ट ने अभी जो सायरा बानो केस हुआ था उसमें सुप्रीम कोर्ट ने कहा कि किसी प्रॉपर केस में हम नरसू अप्पा माली केस को एनालाइज करेंगे, इसमें नहीं करते. लेकिन सुप्रीम कोर्ट ने बहुत सारे प्रोविजंस को इंटरप्रेट किया जो पर्सनल लॉज के. मैं इस फेवर में हूं कि पर्सनल लॉज में इनइक्वालिटीज हैं, अगर पर्सनल लॉज को हम लॉज मान लेंगे विद इन आर्टिकल 13 तो बहुत सारी इनइक्वालिटीज दूर हो जाएंगे. लेकिन सुप्रीम कोर्ट तक ने पर्सनल लॉज को लॉज नहीं माना है. और शायद आपको एक केस याद होगा, श्री कृष्ण सिंह वर्सेस मथुरा अहीम, उसमें सवाल यह था कि वेदर अ दलित कैन बी अ प्रीस्ट ऑफ अ टेम्पल और नॉट. सुप्रीम कोर्ट ने कहा कि वी कैन नॉट इंटरप्रेट रिलीजियस स्क्रिप्चर्स, हम रिलीजियस स्क्रिप्चर्स इंटरप्रेट नहीं कर सकते, ये पर्सनल लॉ का मसला है. पर्सनल लॉज को हम कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल जो स्क्रूटनी है फंडामेंटल राइट्स की उस पर हम कस नहीं सकते. तो बहुत सारी चीजें हैं, और ये क्यों आ रहा है, ये वो अपब्रिंगिंग से आ रहा है, जो बचपन से लेकर जो मेरी एक तरह से अपब्रिंगिंग हुई है वो अपब्रिंगिंग से आ रहा है, और इसीलिए मैं समझता हूँ कि कास्ट सेंसस होना चाहिए, पता लगना चाहिए कि कौन कितने प्रिविलेजेस उठा रहा है, कौन कम होते हुए भी सदियों से आज भी जो है वो डोमिनेंट पोजीशंस में है और वही डिसीजन मेकिंग में है। और जब तक मार्जिनलाइज सेक्शन डिसीजन मेकिंग में नहीं आएंगे तब तक सोशल जस्टिस की बात नहीं की जा सकती, जब तक सब्सटेंटिव जस्टिस की बात नहीं की जा सकती। तो मैं आप यहीं पर अपनी बात खत्म करना चाहूंगा। माई पार्टी एंड आई एम इन टोटल आई टोटल फेवर दैट देयर मस्ट बी यू नो ऑल कास्ट सेंसस होना चाहिए, सिर्फ ओबीसी का नहीं होना चाहिए बल्कि ऑल कास्ट सेंसस होना चाहिए। तभी मैं समझता हूँ कि सोसाइटी की जो हकीकत है वही निकल कर आएगी और उससे फिर हम अपनी पॉलिसीज बना सकते हैं, क्योंकि जब आपके डाटा होगा तो आप टारगेटेड पॉलिसीज बना सकते हैं। जब तक आपके पास डेटा नहीं तब तक आप टारगेटेड पॉलिसीज नहीं बना सकते। तो ये हमारी कंट्री का जो पब्लिक इंटरेस्ट है या पब्लिक वेलफेयर है उसके भी इंटरेस्ट में है कि हमारे पास डेटा होना चाहिए। बहुत बहुत शुक्रिया, धन्यवाद।
थैंक यू अब्दुल जी सर, वेरी पावरफुल प्रेजेंटेशन। आई थिंक यू क्लियरली ब्रॉट आउट द डबल स्टैंडर्ड्स इन कास्ट हिंदूज, दैट व्हेन इट्स अ क्वेश्चन ऑफ प्रिविलेजेस दे सीम टू बी थिंकिंग दैट देयर शुड बी नो कास्ट, but when it is a question of their privileges getting affected, then they think that caste is a problem and therefore they do not want caste to be counted. So I think the one of the important points that you're mentioning, that the social powers that upper caste have to make a choice when to become upper caste and when not to become upper caste and when to become casteless, I think that itself is a kind of a social power which maybe other castes do not have. OBC does not himself decide when he is an OBC and when he is not. So I think that invisibility of caste privileges, I think is what you are hinting at, that this caste census would kind of expose. So I now invite with great pleasure Professor Sujata Surapalli, who is a very well-known activist and a much liked social activist across Telangana. And Sujata, over to you.
Yeah, thank you, Ajay. I think there's nothing left after Rafis ji spoke about everything. But I would like to share my experience here from Telangana. And also, as a teacher of sociology, I think we are anyway caste society, India. But the government wants to make it as a class society. You know, that is why, economic basis, a reservation for economic basis. And they, at particular point, whenever the issue of caste comes, it again immediately triggers the reservation, it immediately triggers the merit, it immediately triggers the inequality, everything comes. So, but when the reservation introduced by Baba Saheb Ambedkar, I think it is just for 10 years and, with the reservations in education, in politics, in, employment, probably, these inequalities will go. But unfortunately, till date, all the educated, I'm happy with the uneducated, but and at some point, we are consolidating it rather than, mitigating it, rather than annihilating it. What happened is 2 years back, I did a study in scheduled caste in Telangana with the Council for Social Development. To my surprise, we have actually 61 castes, scheduled castes in Telangana and earlier erstwhile Andhra Pradesh. And in 5 districts, I could only locate 25 castes. I was very surprised, where are all the other 61 castes were there? Again, that caste was made before the independence, the huge list of scheduled castes. And then I inquired in a couple of government offices. Some castes actually were, you go to the collector office and you will easily get a caste certificate. And some castes, very minute, small castes within the scheduled castes, they don't get a caste certificate easily. So I think I also come from a very small subcaste. So they started migrating to the other Mala Madiga caste to, get the caste certificate. So my rough estimation was most of the small subcastes, due to the complexity in getting the certificates, they have migrated to the nearby caste. So this reality is, being a Dalit, having, attending so many activities, I come to know that the huge number has reduced, and or maybe the research area is not having that, but I probably 90% I did inquiries and all. So this is an indication that if you don't have a data, proper data, and how are you going to make a policies or beneficiaries? That is one part. But the other part is like, is it really very difficult to get a data? I think it's no, because there is a saying in Bihar politics, I think all of you know that in Bihar, they don't cast their vote, but they vote for caste, right? So every political party has a data, and every political party has the caste congregations. And because I am also one of the contested in elections in 2017 from BSP, that every politician and every party has, before entering into the ground, we all have a caste data. It is not a difficult to get a data, but it is the difficult to, you know, interpret it. Because now whenever the caste census, we are talking about only OBCs. As Hafizji was saying, that we're not talking about all others. Recently, me and other Professor Bangia has edited the D&T tribes for EPW on an issue. And we were very surprised, even after 75 years, we are talking about the people who are denotified. We are not even notified them. And we say most backward caste and all. So we have in India people who are not notified as a human beings because they're nowhere. They're nowhere in the any caste groups. And they are criminal tribes, they're denotified tribes. And that part we have, we left it. But the other side, if Telangana you take, we have pakka caste data because our government gives pigs to pig rearers, fishes to fisher communities, goats to, you know, goat rearers, Yadavs and all. But if you come, the whole question here comes, which community is availed the most privileges? Like earlier speaker was saying, that everybody, even a blind man in India can say that, even in judiciary, in politics, in all IITs, in universities, only one community, which is not even 5% or a 3%, enjoying every reservation. But now we have a contrary, that the central government says that delaying the caste census. And one part of BJP wants a caste census, but it is, again, we can simply understand it's a whole, more than a social justice point of view, it is an election funda that most of the groups want a caste census, then that is coming from there. And here the central government don't want a caste census because of the, you know, for last 10 years, we are at least school enrollment says that 121 crores to 137, an estimation from the school enrollment, that it is clearly saying, because in the, at least in the child enrollment, now we have universal enrollment system, it says that 45% OBCs, and government has a 15%, but 90% SCs, and they are saying 17%, 11% STs. So if we really want a caste data, it is not a difficult, but government is delaying. Whenever I look for this, the whole issue and the complexity, I think it comes to my mind, the women's reservation bill, you know. I think the only bill which is pending in India for decades, because every time we raise the issue, they say that all possible things they put in as 25% to upper caste, this caste, and I remember one MP statement that, why do I sign on my death penalty, you know, in the context of reservation bill. So my point is that if your government wants caste census. It is not a big deal. We can get it. And we do have statewide on different policies and programs and school enrollments, and not as accurate as the census perhaps, but definitely we have certain data which is available. But when we talk about the caste, I said that we talk about the reservations and privileged sections. These three things come to place. But for me as an Ambedkarite, when we talk about the caste, annihilation of caste should come first, because that will never come first, because we don't talk about it, our policies are not into it. And suddenly people will realize that by counting the caste, then we are dividing the society. As Mahatma Gandhi said that when we ask for separate electorates, that you are dividing the people. No, because caste is such a rigid thing that unless we want to annihilate it, and it cannot be annihilated. But we don't have that agenda at all, because through constitution, the entire framework is equality, you know, liberty, freedom. But we are guided by Manusmriti, then the constitution. But even the caste census, those who are asking for it, those who are delaying for it, both wants the caste to be, you know, to be intact and to be present. Because one particular thing is, during lockdown, we saw that, I mean, one or two points, earlier speaker covered, that migrant issue, we have seen that during the lockdown. And also education, we have seen how it is impacting, not having a data, how it is impacting. Forget about the reservation, because Ajay already said that we are no more a welfare state. So when there is no more welfare state, then there is no jobs and reservation, right? We are not even a capitalist. So when we are not a welfare state, then we obviously do not have reservations. But I don't know, but the whole topic discussion goes around reservations. So I think about the reservations in private sector. Obviously, because Ambedkar wanted these vulnerable groups in the hands of the government, because he clearly, he has a picture that in caste society, these minorities, Dalits, tribals, women, they don't get a justice. That's why government has to, do justice for these communities. But government is operating through caste lines, because votes in politics, as Kanshiram said, man, muzzle, all those money, media, mafia, all those things. Now, caste is one important thing in the politics. So this caste, everybody wants, and it is very much clear, because in Telangana, we have a one-day survey. It's a very big event after the Telangana form. Even that time, they have calculated the caste of the entire Telangana. So my point is that caste qualifications are clear, but they don't want to publish it because for schooling, either for policies, either for reservations. And if you talk about the nomadic tribes, either that whole point is lost. We missed that nomadic tribes, and we are also missing the minorities, because OBCs, one more question had come, why only OBCs? So if we see the Indian situation as of now, only OBCs are holding the Hinduism. That is very clear, because SCST somehow, of course, STs are also into the Hindu fold. So this whole Hinduism is directly linked to the OBC caste census. So that is one thing. So I'll close by saying that why we are asking reservations in private sector, because there is no option. There is no government jobs and reservation. Obviously, you have private sector and private sector is also availing the government benefits. So when private sector is availing the government benefits, then people have a right to ask for a reservation. So that is how reservation. And dividing the society, we are already divided society. And I don't think that unless we work with the aim of annihilation of caste, we still remain a divisive society. And that is a very far dream. I'll stop here.
Thanks,
I don't know if I make it any sense.
Yeah, of course. I think the absolute clarity that caste, I think we have to be very clear that the census is not creating any new division. It is only highlighting those divisions and the discrimination and privileges on the other side that have already existed for a very long time. So I think there need to be no confusion that the census is not going to create any new kind of. And as you have rightly pointed out that we are debating reservations for such long time, but there are hardly any jobs left in the government sector, and we are debating for about 2% jobs. I think the entire social justice has got reduced around. So I think that question we need to, how is caste census going to really alter that situation? Or is it going to only exacerbate demanding something that actually does not actually exist? You know,
yes.
That how is caste census going to help? I think something like the Muslim question, that you know, you have such a huge narrative of Muslim appeasement. Well, all social economic indicators show they are actually on the decline, but the narrative is something else, and therefore there's a false debate. So one of the questions we might want to pick up later is that how is this caste census going to help us in this large scale social economic division that exists? Are we going to end up fighting for something that does not exist? You know, in the government, there's hardly any jobs left. And with this new government, there's now what is called monetization.
Ajay, one minute. That because we are identified with our caste, right? Elsewhere, maybe in other countries, you are identified as a human being or a citizen, right? Here, that's why we demand for a caste census, because denotified tribes is the right example, because you are not notified at all. So, but to be, this is also a question of notifying as a citizen that you exist here. So that is how, through the caste, not as a human being. So that's probably the one more.
Yes, true, yeah. I agree. So that is, I think, I remember once discussing with Gopal Guru, he made this point when I was critiquing informalization. He said for a Dalit to move from village to urban in an informal sector itself is a kind of a mobility. So I think we are stuck with a very complex situation, where we really do not know. We talk about annihilation of caste, but we really do not know where to begin. How do you begin to kind of annihilate caste? So on that front, with that, I think we'll move to my good friend Chandan, who is heading a national party. So he has additional responsibility of telling us how we can go about undoing these social privileges. And what does caste annihilation actually mean for him? Okay, over to you, Chandan.
Chandan sir, please unmute yourself.
Yeah, thank you, Arun ji, Ajay ji, Sujata ji, Abdul ji, for giving me an opportunity to discuss. Some sort of a discussion on this very topic. And finally, Arunji, you have take out the big fat elephant from drawing room, and we are discussing about caste. It's very heartening to see. The problem with the entire public intellectual of all colors was some sort of an ostrich-like escapism on the idea of caste. So what I have been seeing for a month at least, much has been written about. Public intellectuals of all colors have been writing about. And before getting into the details of this, let me tell you what is very clear about caste census. What is caste census is all about? Where is the real issue? The real issue is for the counting of other backward castes. Already the countings for scheduled castes, scheduled tribes, and religious minorities exist. The problem only lies with now counting of all the castes, not only the counting their heads, but also their economic prosperity, their representation in every space of life, the distribution of wealth, land, everything. So recently we saw a report by, NSSO, which said that 10% of population has the control over almost 60% of resources. So now the question caste sessions will throw is who all constitute this 10% of the population. Usme kaun kaun se log hain, kahan se aa rahe hain, unki kya social profiling hai. So in a sense, the major problem lies in, or the major question that comes is only many of the intellectuals, those who are opposed to this caste census, as Ajay Gudavarti has rightly pointed, has five apprehensions they have, is on what they're going to do with the caste census. Like, if they are counting caste groups, how it is going to help it. So in that sense, let's start by suggesting, you talked about, let me take the first example of how the Hindutva, like I had been hearing and being written about also by many public intellectuals, that OBC is considered to be now the main careers of Hindutva ideology, or it's like they're to be blamed to be becoming more communal. But the fact of the matter is 70 crore population if suggests they belongs to OBC community, or more than that, because I'm just quoting BP Mandal way back according to 1931 census. And so that time there were only 4,000 castes in amongst OBCs. Now there are about more than 6,500 castes. So I don't know what is the real OBC population exactly, because more and more castes have been included, including the central list, and now the state has been given. Now my main focus will be on that Hindutva, the idea of Hindutva, as one of the, I heard public intellectuals suggesting, if you are not Hindus, then we are Brahmins, we are Yadavs, we are Kshatriyas, we are Rajputs, we are EBCs, we are Dalits. So in that sense, it's okay to have a social discrimination based on caste. It is okay to have not addressing the issue of social diversity in every spheres of our democracy. As Abdulji has already pointed out, and so as Sujata, you know, you consider these four pillars of democracy, whether bureaucracy, judiciary, corporates, and press. So 10% on 90% of white collar jobs where the decisions making takes place in Lutyens Delhi or in any Lutyens capital, I mean, whether in Patna, whether in Lucknow, the decision making body where the policies are being formed, where policies related to population of this country are being drafted, there hardly you see any kind of diversity being respected. And all of us know in academics, okay, the diversity brings better results. Diversity gives you better policy making. So why not that idea of social diversity is being practiced or being addressed? So caste census, not having a caste census, is giving rise to so many problems in that sense. If people are now coming to conclusion or making a sweeping statement on the basis of hearsay, not having a concrete data, reservation has not benefited, why reservation will continue for only 10 years, why reservation the idea of reservation is giving rise to more casteism, why particular caste has taken the most benefit out of it. We have no data to support this. In fact, I was just going through one data by Christopher Jeffrelet, where he has claimed in Bihar ki the dominant community in Bihar, the per capita income of that dominant community is less than most of the EBC's communities. Maybe, yes, certain dominant communities do got the benefit of electoral domain, may they got benefited because of this mandalization of politics. Definitely the dominant community by their sheer numbers in democracy, they have got benefited. But when it comes to the per capita income of that community, when it comes to their education profiling, when it comes to their land holdings, they are far, far behind many of the other dominant communities, including Uttar Pradesh and Bihar. To say that the majority of the benefit were taken away by the dominant OBC communities is factually wrong. You can't have such a sweeping statement without having required supporting data on that. So to address all the hearsay that has emerged out of the reservation idea is to have a caste census. Now that will make doodh ka doodh, pani ka pani. It is very simple. Okay, these are the communities that have been not being representation. They are hardly represented in group A, group B, group C, or group D, whatever diversity you want to address, or say, okay, 50% of the population is having control over 80% of the resources and 80% of the position. So that needs to be addressed. If there is a pattern, a certain section of a society or a certain community has been traditionally lagging behind, then it's a responsibility of any democratically elected welfare government to see that their representation, the social capital of the country, is being looked upon, not only and so that and then it the entire majority population also becomes the part of the nation building. So caste, having a caste census will definitely contribute towards better nation building. You know, we the people. So, and you are leaving half of the population of this country. You are saying, don't count them, don't have a data. What is their problem? So it's a dirty kind of an idea to get indulged into a caste. So that's not going to solve the problem, I guess. More idea is the caste is a complex issue. So the democracy is also complex. So we have to address it. So how to address it? We can count it. There is no idea ki there is no if there is no, I guess, logistics problem involving in collecting data, because we have done till 1931. And if you are collecting NRC data, which is much more complex, why we can't collect caste data? Class data will give answer or will make people realize a cross section of the community that justice has been done to them. If a Yadav feels, because what is happening at present is Yadav, or for that matter EBCs in Uttar Pradesh and in Bihar, feels majority of the reservation benefit is being taken away by Yadavs. But the fact of the matter is the community Kurmi has much more per capita land than Yadavs, much more educationally upward than Yadavs. So I'm just throwing certain here and there. And so as majority of EBC's communities, so they are better off than in many of the dominant communities. Yes, so how we'll come to know? We'll come to know only when the data are being laid in front, where the concrete data, credible data is in front of us, so that any community will also feel ki, okay, justice has been done, or they have been, people will know why my reservation is taken away. If the data throws, ki, okay, the dominant committee is now very well represented, they're adequately represented, move out them from the reservation list, bring in those communities, those who are being left behind. To address all these kinds of a problem within communities, within OBCs, there is a problem. EBC, like in Bihar, in many of the states, that has been taken care of. There have been EBCs and OBCs. There have been two categories in place in Bihar and other few states. So all this democracy will throw. Society is dynamic. So the caste dynamics will also keep changing, because castes do get impacted by politics, democracy. You know, not only in Bihar and Uttar Pradesh, in one thing, they're very highly sensitive towards the idea of caste. Very aware about their rights, caste rights, aware about that. It's not, it's happening in Telangana also, it's happening in Andhra also, it's happening in Karnataka also, everywhere. But yes, the degree and intensity of their assertiveness among certain section of the society, the manifestation and intensity keeps changing. But people do consider caste as one of their main tools for their livelihoods. It does help them. It has made their life. It has broken their life. So it does impact people in total well-being. So not to collect data and leaving half of the population of this country on the whims and fancies of hearsays is not going to solve towards nation building. How can we imagine a nation without 50% of we the people? That's not possible. So to take them along in towards the nation building, to involve all these people, to make them feel they're part of India. How do you make them feel they're part of India? Because their people are also being represented. You know, certainly yesterday's after the incident, I mean, that changeover in Punjab, now you see what kind of narrative is now being built up. People are talking about, people are praising about. No, people from a deprived section has been given opportunity. One, people who has come from a very humble background. So what I'm just trying to say is democracy, identity will play a role. It's not only playing in India, but across globe. So as long as identity is there, identity-based discrimination is there, where on the basis of religion, caste, creed, color, language, gender, ethnicity, culture, whatever. So all these things will keep up playing. Not to address that issue, not to collect data. We have many examples in US, the race issue, how it was tackled, because they collected every decade, they collect various kind of data to understand how the idea of race is being played in society. So in India, how the idea of caste, especially in North India, is playing. Why Tamil Nadu and Maharashtra, they're doing a good job as far as the governance issue is concerned? Because they are socially much more well represented, some sort of a thing, because the social diversity idea is they have taken care of long back. In North India especially, what has happened is the socio-cultural revolution hasn't taken place. Politicization of caste has taken place. So for that regard, now it is up to the entire society to stand up and see that either you abolish the caste system. You know, it's not ki reservation came first and then caste system came. It is a reservation is a product of the caste system. So if you are not able to abolish the caste system, then as Abdulji rightly said, we have to have such sort of means to address the discrimination that exists on the basis of caste is being minimized, is being controlled, is being taken care of, is being heard about. So the caste census will give answer, satisfaction, and some sort of a justice to every group. Because many public intellectuals will also feel, because they're academically oriented, so they can understand if this is the data, and based on this data, the government is making such policies, so that needs to be addressed. But what is happening is, what are the main problem that is being raised by the people, those who are against reservation? 50% cap will go up, reservation caste census hoga, and they fear that OBC in numbers are going to increase, then 50% reservation ka cap hat jayega, and people will start asking for more reservation, and all these things are always keeping in their mind. Now, as a child, we were taught to share and care. So as long as the population of this country, we start thinking of sharing and caring power, to share power and to care for each other. So that, with that policy in mind, with that intention in mind, I guess if we move forward, I guess we are able to be able to do justice to the entire population of this country, and also we will be able to do justice to our nations. And as far as the dynamics within upper caste versus OBC, OBC versus Dalits, Dalit versus Mahadalits, Mahadalit versus most backwards, and all these things, in Bihar there is a Dalit versus Mahadalit. So the society will keep evolving. That's how the democracy gets deepening. And once the democracy starts reaching to Mahatma Gandhi's last man out, so it will happen. That's part of, that's how society gets evolved. So we have to keep re-looking at those policies, keep collecting data, and based on that, we need to change policy from time to time, so that the dynamism of the society, the social dynamics of our country is being captured properly so that a proper policy and a proper question that is being raised in the society is being covered up. I'm very clear about this, that Hindutva gets, the idea of Hindutva is India is basically a religious country. And the more poor you are, generally there is a tendency towards the manifestation of your religious practices will be much more intense, which will be much more passionate than if you are better. Well, it's not a one, I mean, majority of people, those who are poor, had this kind of a tendency. So to practice their religion and the, yes, of late in northern India, the Hindutva, the idea of Hindutva is definitely because of the central government is there. They're doing a bit of a social engineering. It's not a social justice. So as some sort of a representation, and that happens in politics. It's like when Mandal came, it was upper caste versus backward caste. When Nitish came to Bihar, it was backward caste versus most backward caste. So that things will keep evolving. The caste coalition will keep changing because that's how the society will get impacted. So, and also, as I said, my take on this is the caste census is the problem to address the issue of caste discrimination in India. If you are not able to abolish the caste system, then this is the best way. I guess it will take care of three things. A, it will give a sense of justice and rationalism to people of all section of the society. Those who are in favor of reservation as a policy, those who are not, those who are benefited from the reservation, those who are not. Some sort of a rational logic is there so that one can get content with that policy. The B part is that better policy making in India will prevail. The target group, which Abdulji was also talking about, because enough is enough. Poverty now needs to be airlifted, or something surgical strike, or something with the proper lack of data. We need to strike where it matters, where it's going to help us. So that for that data is required. And also the data will give a better part in addressing and learning the process of the entire governance model, social policies, everything. So that will help us in judging on getting into more towards nation building, and also help the society evolve and keep the idea of caste in a, if we are not able to abolish, let's, some of the research have also been done and conducted how caste plays an important role in community development, like how the business community, they help each other in promoting the community business, as sense like how your caste help in people doing good business. Like there are a lot of research has been done on this. So caste can also play important role in the development of this country. If you're not abolish, we are not able to abolish the system, then let's have do it in a constructive way. So caste, the idea of caste should be taken in a constructive way also. So how far we can do that, that will help us. Thank you.
Thank you, Chandan, for that interesting presentation. So you're actually suggesting that contrary to popular beliefs that caste census will make caste rigid, you're saying that caste census, caste data might actually make it more flexible, that you might have caste included, and if they are privileged enough, they might move out of reservations and other social benefits, and you can have newer caste coming in, and that will make newer social coalitions possible. So that's an interesting proposition one can think about. But let me begin the discussion with a kind of a question that I think is at the back of those who are apprehensive. Also in general, I think it's a relevant question, is that, which I think has also come through in all your three presentations, that while we all strongly believe that this will advance the project of social justice, what about the concern that this kind of, if we get caught in this kind of a business of census, microscopic allocation according to caste basis, it might potentially derail the big questions. Like I said, against privatization. What about, for instance, a demand, as I said, Sujaita is also involved with, a right to education. But education is a fundamental right. We need to have a common school system in India, cutting across upper caste, lower caste, across regions, classes, so on and so forth. Similarly, education, similarly health. Now, what about spending GDP? We are abysmally low. We are less than even Bangladesh. What about demands of that kind, you know, which can actually uplift us from these kind of microscopic social conflicts? You know, so are we pushing a second best society? Something that came across in your all three presentations is that since we are not anyway doing away with caste, since we are not doing annihilation of caste, then this is our second best bet, that at least allocate whatever little resources are there, you know, you allocate within the across caste discrimination. So I think I see the flip side of this kind of policy making is that it might permanently move us away from a social vision, you know, which would demand that the state should invest 10% of GDP on universal education, let's say 8% of GDP on universal healthcare, which is what Scandinavian countries have done, a small country like Bangladesh has done. Indian democracy somehow, because of this huge, humongous inequity we have created between castes and within subaltern castes, between upper castes and other castes, we are not caught. We are somewhere caught in between. We do not really know how to wriggle out of this situation. So, I mean, in that kind of a context, I would agree that caste census is about, would you agree that caste census is about redistributing whatever little is there? You know, you have 100 people and you have 5 posts. So this caste census, what it will do is that, you know, we are caught in an endemic cycle of redistributing a small portion among a humongous large population. So, I mean, I see a flip side, which we need to be cautious with political parties, you know, like Congress brought in the Nyay scheme. Of course, it did not work for various reasons one can discuss. But I felt that was a huge scheme to jumpstart distributing resources. So what happens to those big demands? I mean, if we are caught within this kind of, you know, continuously talking only about, because the social inequity, as Piketty's study has also shown globally, is increasing so many folds. You know, that so one thing that we may agree is that caste census does not lead to any radical redistribution. It is not going to restructure things in any fundamental manner. It is only about within the existing developmental model we have, where all political parties from left to Congress are in support of a neoliberal model of development, privatize entire wealth, and there is small portion which is what we are discussing how to redistribute. So, I mean, you know, in terms of public, one big thing is, of course, what Abdul said, that, you know, public participation. So, I mean, will this, suppose having this model of growth, let's say we have 10 OBC judges, what big difference is it going to make? No, we have had Dalit MPs, we have had Dalit MLAs from since independence, but they have failed to make any big impact because the social power is so big. So my point to start kickstart this discussion would be that the apprehension that, you know, this lopsidedness of social power cannot change perhaps through these strategies. This is the second best strategy we have. You know, like somebody said, Churchill said, democracy, parliamentary democracy is the worst system, but the best we can have. Is it something along that we are discussing caste census? So I'll ask Chandan, you want to go first, and then maybe Abdul and
Sujaita. I guess we need to understand addressing the identity issue, especially the caste question in India, is not some sort of a poverty alleviation program it's not only an economic prosperity program. It's about the social capital that you are trying to create in nation, a kind of a social harmony that you are investing in. If society is being divided on the basis of caste, and there is a bit of amnesty amongst caste, you know, society, there always be a law and order problem. So the idea is the feeling of we the people means it's the country is made from we the people. If people feel discriminated, if the people feel being left out, if people feel they're being treated as a second grade citizens. So if people, they feel they are less privileged. So these are the emotive issues. Elections are not only not only economics are the issues. Emotions are also the issues which needs to be captured and which needs to be sort of addressed to. I guess it's not ki that mehgai, berojgari, garibi, privatization, globalization, these are not the, these are all definitely an issue. But to say that these are primary issues and let's focus on that and we should not focus on the secondary issues like caste, I guess we'll be missing the bus. I guess it's, if you take both and 70 years of our independence and still the social diversity is very challenging. So if you don't address the issue, poor are becoming poorer. It's not much, I guess, in a sense of percentage wise, if you look, there's not much, much has been done, but still half glass is only half filled. In that sense, we need to go further in a sense of in a democracy, the idea of representation is also equally important to address than those economic issues. Why? I mean, it's not key that the private, because we can't have the class and caste idea. Address it as a class issue, and once that happens, the caste issue will be automatically taken care of. I don't think so, because a Dalit, even if he becomes a capitalist, he or she will still be a Dalit, or a Brahmin who's a proletariat will always be a Brahmin. That you can't take away their privilege if a Brahmin is a proletariat, or if a Dalit is a capitalist. Do you think they are equal? No. So that idea is totally different. The more we connect the idea of identity to caste, if for example Muslims, so no matter if they start feeling they are being treated by this government as a secondary citizen, no matter amount of economics or rojgar you give them to every source of facilities, they're not going to be happy. Is that we are looking for? So I guess we need to look at the idea of identity. We are addressing the idea of identity-based discrimination. So unless and it cannot be addressed through class only, it can only be some sort of the crude manifestation will change. If you address it only through class, the crude manifestation, like earlier times, people were using abusive word, class slurs were being used. Now with the education and class, there have been untouchability has been lessened and all these kind of things has definitely taken place. But still 94% of people marry within their caste. You know, still 60% of the resources are being captured by the upper caste. So these are all the ideas there and people see it. And there are caste-based discrimination. Why 90% of white collar jobs are being held by 20% of the population. And 10%, these are there to be seen. It has to be addressed in that sense, I guess. It's...
Do you agree, Sujata, with that? So Chandan seems to be suggesting that it is about fighting social discrimination and not about large-scale economic inequalities. I think Anand Teltumde has been one scholar who has continuously cautioned us that getting entangled in these discussions of reservation, they have after all benefited only 4-6% of Dalits, and 96% or 94% have been left behind. That we simply don't today have an agenda for rest of them. You know, so this kind of a caste census. Therefore, Chandan is raising an important point that what Abdul also raised. You know, in terms of diversity and representation and social discrimination might be addressed through caste census, but it might also, the danger is it might block out the big. The question that actually all groups together need to raise. How do you look at it?
Ajay, just a rider. What I said is that economic issue is definitely there. We need to address that. But to club it together and you say that for the time being, nation is facing economic crisis. So forget the idea of identity and fight for nationalization of health, education and everything. That will take care of my caste identity. That will... It has to go both ways. It's not either or.
Either or.
That is what I mean.
Actually, yes. Ajay, I think let us not get confused with the economic reforms and nationalization and everything, because we are talking about identity based on caste. It has its own, its own importance, because if we want, suppose let us take education, then there are many communities that who have not gone to school, the first generation of school, because no data. So why we need a data? Because there is no data, so no schools. And maybe if we identify that so many people are uneducated, first generation people are there, then we might think of a school. You know, that happened in a health sector also recently in COVID times, because we just talk about the stay home, stay safe. But I was wondering that many people do not have home, but our caption is stay home and stay safe, right? So we by generalizing the, you know, thinking that we are all equal, in India, it doesn't happen. So caste census is different. I mentioned the denotified tribes, not interchanging with the caste, but everybody should be counted, like minorities, tribes, and castes. In that context, I mentioned that. Because as long as we are academicians, because without data, we are not going to do anything, right? So that data, unfortunately, in India is based on the caste, right? Based on the caste, if not caste, suppose. So now how many people are just not in the list, not in the schedule, not in the policies, not in the education, not in the health, not in the housing, right? Forget about the judiciary and who are in the judges and who are in the IIT professors and all that. I'm talking about the basic first entry of the school system. So let us not get confused with the data. We need to have a data, because 2011 is gone. You know, 21 now that people are saying lockdown has come, and from how much data we have, we really don't know. But state-wise, if we can have it, I'm sure Telangana must be having all the data of caste. And that I did not reveal the NSS data. I just gave you the United District Information System on Education data, which now Universal Education Enrollment is giving a column of caste. So through children's caste, we have an estimation of how many OBCs are there, STs are there, in the Hindus, not all others again, right? So by collecting the data, we are going to have some benefits. But whether we collect the data or don't collect the data, you're not going to do anything with the economics, right? You're not going to do anything with the reservations. So we are talking about, yes, there is this community living where they are living. Are they living or not? Are they in the enrolled for education or not? But I am sure in India, if you take the election and voters list, everybody is there, right? Everybody is there. When everybody is there, then they should be having some kind of a identity. I am sure they have an identity. If you see the Telangana people who are in the slums, people who came migrated from Guttikoyas or other areas, everybody has a voter card, right? But it, as I said, it is not a difficult to identify, because we are already doing some programs and policies based on the caste. But the problem is coming that people are thinking that if we count this OBCs, then we have to count how many privileged castes have availed the reservations. Okay, that is visible everywhere. So it's not going to disturb, and we're not going to, you know, pull them down. But definitely inequality will be visible. So let us not get into any other aspect when we are talking about the data.
Would you agree with that, Abdullah? Because you referred to this explicitly, that since we could not do annihilation of caste, then you said that census is the... So you, I mean, what perhaps came across in your presentation was it looked like the second best option. And therefore, my question again would be, what happens to big demands? Who would raise it? I mean, if we are all caught in this redistributing within the limited resources, can we mount pressure on political parties like your part, Samajwadi and Congress, that, you know, have big GDP allocations for health and education?
Dr. Ajay ji, it's not about only redistribution of resources. I also know that resources are limited. So we are not talking of the redistribution of resources. What I'm emphasizing is the institutional bias. संस्थागत जो एक भेदभाव है हमारे समाज के अंदर, which I call institutional bias. So until or unless you do not have representation from the weaker section, for example, in an interview board, you cannot eliminate institutional bias unless you have a women member there, unless you have a SC/ST there. So that is why I am saying that it is a fact that we have an institutional bias, and that is why we need representation in every section, in every sphere of life, public institution, private institution, we need representation. So this is one of the points. Now the second is that what is the harm in measuring the disadvantages and privileges that result from caste system? I should not think that there must be an objection to this measurement of disadvantages and privileges which result from the caste system. मुझे लगता है कि हमें पता होना चाहिए कि disadvantages क्या हैं और कौन कौन लोग privilege उसका ले रहे हैं, तभी तो हम proper allocation कर पाएंगे. अगर हमारे पास लिमिटेड रिसोर्सेज हैं और हम चाहते हैं कि सभी सेक्शंस ऑफ सोसाइटी का डेवलपमेंट हो, तो मुझे लगता है कि विद प्रिसिशन हम तभी कर पाएंगे जब हमारे पास डेटा होगा. वरना होगा क्या, जैसे मैंने इंस्टीट्यूशन बायस की बात की थी कि बांधा एग्रीकल्चर यूनिवर्सिटी में ऑल प्रोफेसर्स विल बी फ्रॉम वन पर्टिकुलर कास्ट, नो ओबीसी, नो SC/ST, एंड वन मिनिस्टर्स ब्रदर, एजुकेशन मिनिस्टर्स ब्रदर इन यूपी would get the assistant professor in a university under the EWS quota, despite the fact that very particular community is overrepresented. और उसके बावजूद भी आपने EWS quota लेकर आए, और उसका फायदा कौन उठा रहा है? Minister's brother. तो सवाल यहां सिर्फ redistribution का नहीं है, सवाल यहां पर संस्थागत जो एक भेदभाव है, जो institutional bias है, उसको किस तरह से हम एलिमिनेट कर सकते हैं. और मैं तो ये कहूंगा कि अगर शायद उस क्लास में, जिस क्लास में बाबा साहब थे, अगर 2-3-4-5 लोग और रहे होते, तो मुझे लगता है कि भारत और अच्छा रहा हो रहता. क्योंकि ये जो डिस्क्रिमिनेशन है, ये आज का डिस्क्रिमिनेशन नहीं, ये एक्युमुलेटेड एट्रोसिटीज का सेंस है, वो एक दो जनरेशन में नहीं जाता है. कहते हैं कि रिजर्वेशन इतने सालों से दे रहे हैं, तब भी क्यों जो है ये ग्रुप्स बार बार डिमांड कर रहे हैं. सुप्रीम कोर्ट ने भी कई केसेस में कहा है कि ओबीसी में तो क्रीमी लेयर है, SC/ST में भी क्रीमी लेयर होना चाहिए, ताकि जो है वो बेनिफिट्स वहां पर पहुंचे. और जैसा अभी चंदन जी ने कहा कि रिजर्वेशन और सोशल जस्टिस पॉलिसीज, दे आर नॉट यू नो पॉवर्टी एलिवेशन प्रोग्राम्स, दे आर मेंट फॉर समथिंग एल्स. They are meant for providing dignified life to the people who have been denied dignity all through their existence since centuries. So we need to address that. और इसलिए मुझे लगता है, जैसे मैंने कहा कि we need to measure disadvantages and privileges that result from the caste system. ये मुझे लगता है कि अगर हम एक समाज के तौर पर evolve करना चाहते हैं, तो ये पता होना चाहिए कि कम होते हुए भी, देखिए ये बहुत एक नॉर्मलाइज हो चुका है अजय जी. आई टेक द एग्जांपल फ्रॉम द सुप्रीम कोर्ट. सर्टेन जजेस फ्रॉम वन पर्टिकुलर कास्ट वर अपॉइंटेड एंड नोबडी ऑब्जेक्टेड. क्यों? क्योंकि हम नॉर्मलाइज कर चुके हैं कि उस कास्ट से अगर आप आते हैं तो आप आ सकते हैं. सपोज इन दैट एग्जांपल, इफ टू पीपल फ्रॉम माइनॉरिटी कम्युनिटी वर सेलेक्टेड और टू पीपल फ्रॉम SC/ST वर सेलेक्टेड, देयर वुड हैव बीन यू नो हेवंस हैव फॉलन. क्यों ऐसा क्यों है कि अगर आप एक पर्टिकुलर कम्युनिटी से आते हैं और ओवर रिप्रेजेंटेड हैं, लेकिन आपका अपॉइंटमेंट वहां पर होता है, तो कोई कुछ नहीं कहता. लेकिन जैसे ही SC/ST कम्युनिटी से, माइनॉरिटी से या अदर डिसएडवांटेज सेक्शन से कोई रिप्रेजेंटेशन एक से ज्यादा हो गया, क्योंकि नेमसेक के लिए आप दे देते हैं, टोकनिज्म में दे देंगे, लेकिन एक से ज्यादा हो गया तो समाज के अंदर हंगामा होता है. क्यों? क्योंकि एक पर्टिकुलर सेक्शन ऑफ सोसाइटी का ओवर रिप्रेजेंटेशन का हमने कभी चैलेंज नहीं किया, हमने बहुत नॉर्मलाइज कर दिया है. और इसलिए मैं समझता हूं कि ये जानना जरूरी है कि कौन कहां पर है, किसके पास पावर है, डिसीजन मेकिंग में कौन है. हम डिसीजन मेकिंग में आना चाहते हैं, और डिसीजन मेकिंग में तब तक नहीं आएंगे जब तक हमें ये ना पता हो कि कौन कहां पर बैठा है, कौन कितना फायदा ले रहा है, और जो सोशल कैपिटल में बार बार बात कर रहा हूं, वो सोशल कैपिटल है कुछ कम्युनिटीज के पास और कुछ के पास नहीं है। तो अगर हमें ये सोशल कैपिटल उन कम्युनिटीज को भी देना है तो उसके लिए हमें कहीं ना कहीं जो है इस तरह की कोशिशें करनी होगी। और मैं समझता हूँ कि कास्ट सेंसस हर चीज के लिए पैनिशिया नहीं है, इट्स नॉट पैनिशिया फॉर ऑल एवरी इल विच इज अफेक्टिंग द इंडियन सोसाइटी, बट आई थिंक इट कैन बी वन ऑफ द मेथड्स टू गिव रिस्पेक्ट डिग्निफाइड लाइफ टू द पीपल हु हैव बीन नेग्लेक्टेड सिंस सेंचुरीज। तो मुझे लगता है कि हम कास्ट सेंसस को पैनिशिया ना समझे हर चीज और सोल्यूशन ना समझे हर चीज का। एक हम सोल्यूशन निकालने की कोशिश कर रहे हैं जिससे समाज में कहीं ना कहीं बराबरी आएगी। जो हम बात कर रहे हैं बार बार की टेंशन समाज के अंदर आएगा, मुझे लगता है जैसा चंदन जी ने लिखा कि अगर आप इकोनॉमिकली थोड़ा सा बढ़ जाएंगे, एजुकेशनली थोड़ा सा अगर आप बढ़ जाएंगे तो वो टेंशन भी कहीं ना कहीं खत्म होती है। क्योंकि जब आप एक पॉइंट पर आ जाते हैं तो एवरी वुड लाइक टू इंटरेक्ट विथ यू, फिर वहां पर जो डिविजन है वो कहीं ना कहीं खत्म होती है। तो जो चंदन जी ने कहा कि जो हम हिंदुत्व की लहर देख रहे हैं या बहुत सारी चीजें देख रहे हैं, अगर आप थोड़ा सा डेवलप कर जाते हैं तो हिंदुत्व की जो लहर है उसको भी कहीं ना कहीं टक्कर मिलेगी। तो मेरी प्रपोजिशन यहाँ ये है कि देखिए कास्ट सेंसस होना चाहिए और कास्ट सेंसस को हर चीज के लिए पैनिशिया नहीं समझ लेना चाहिए, लेकिन कुछ हद तक तो उसे सोल्यूशन होगा। क्योंकि जो पावर पोजिशन की जो रिस्ट्रक्चरिंग है वो मैं समझता हूँ कि भारत के अंदर होना बहुत जरूरी है।
अजय जी एक सवाल जो हम लोग कि द प्रॉब्लम विद सर्टेन सेक्शन ऑफ सोसाइटी एफ्लुएंट सेक्शन ऑफ सोसाइटी इज कि दे आर मोर अपोज्ड टू कास्ट बेस्ड रिजर्वेशन फॉर ओबीसीज। ओके, उसमें नहीं होना चाहिए, ओबीसी की जनसंख्या नहीं गिनी जानी चाहिए। सो द पोजीशन कम्स फ्रॉम द फैक्ट That कि समस्या सारी वही है इसलिए ये कास्ट सेंसस नहीं होना चाहिए, बाकी तो हो ही रहा है सबका। मुझे लगता है उसमें आपके हिसाब से कास्ट बेस्ड रिजर्वेशन शेड्यूल कास्ट में है ना? आप ठीक है, एक जो मेन मोरल ग्राउंड है या जो एक बहुत ही पावरफुल आर्ग्यूमेंट है इज अनटचेबिलिटी दैट हैज बीइंग unleashed among the most vulnerable section of the society. So many of the public intellectual do feel that the caste-based reservation for scheduled caste is okay and they're fine with. But when it comes to the same caste-based reservation for OBCs, they say इनको तो मिलना ही नहीं चाहिए. That a kind of amnesty है, एक angst है, एक दर्द है, एक दुख है. उसका मुझे लगता है दो चीजों को लेकर के है. एक तो somewhere down the line ki the idea of merit, I don't think so the idea of merit is stands out there because jaisa ki hum sahi keh rahe hain ki bahut sare aap dekhenge ki obc ki list aur general ke cut off list bahut states ke service commissions mein barabar aa rahe hain. In fact obcs are scoring much more marks than general category candidates. So the question is not with the obcs, the question is not of untouchability. The question is not about merit. The question is about the representation, lack of representation in the and they suffer because of the institutional biasness, not because of the merit, not because they are not coming up to the mark, but because there is some sort of a bottleneck that as a by the caste Hindus. Somewhere down the line, because the institution has been taken over by most of the affluent section of the society, so there they feel discriminated. So it's a for OBCs, the idea of caste-based reservation is more of a representation in all these sectors of society, in all the pillars of democracy, in all the spheres of life. So I guess on that basis, if you see the data that is being thrown up, that is there in public domain. So you see, it's like everywhere in bureaucracy, in your academics, hardly there are professors from OBC community. And that includes when I say OBC Muslims also. Same is there, OBC mein the Pasmandas Muslims ke jo ek issues address honi chahiye, wo bhi bahut sari nahi aa paate, kyunki somewhere down the line, the alliance of the caste Hindus and caste Muslims, they are on the same page when this idea, whether I mean, when I say the whether it's a left liberal, right liberal, or a centrist liberal, or all sets of liberals and progressive, they're on the same page when they look at the reservation idea related to empowering OBCs. So when you see 60% of a population, they don't have even I guess 18% representation in bureaucracy or something like that. So when you see this mismatch, that's where I guess the answer is not there. So I guess the caste-based reservation OBC is because they is based on that ground, I guess. We need to look at...
I think this is something that we would all agree on. That therefore, the point which we are really making is that caste census, as Abdul said, is not a panacea for everything. Caste census, therefore, what we are saying is about representation, is about social discrimination, is about diversity. If we agree on this, that is essentially a question of representation. My question would be, what happens to the social content? Today, what is happening to BSP in Uttar Pradesh? You have Mayawati with a Trishul wielding and talking about Bahujanism. So I'm saying my apprehension of this kind of a debate on caste census would be to that the social power is so iniquitous in India between a tiny 10% caste Hindus and a 90% of, let's call all of them Bahujan, that merely talking the danger with this kind of a debate of caste census, I would want to highlight is that it really empties this question of representation from social content. The point that Abdul is making again and again, that we want to be in decision making. My point would be that, yes, this system will allow 10 OBCs, 5 Muslims, 4 Dalit women to be in decision making. But what is the what is that we will end up gaining if you have a judge who is a Dalit woman and gives a judgment like Ms. Mayawati now wielding a Trishul and reproducing the same system all over again? So my point is, what about if you have a judge who is Muslim and gives an anti-Muslim judgment? So I think somewhere the cautioning that is coming up, our critique is that we will have to link this question of representation to a robust social content and economic progress. Hum agar sirf is caste census ko sirf ek representation, ek politics of presence, ek sirf dignity ka question. Yes, it's a very important question. Yes, but hamara jo history of reservations has shown that mere presence does not somehow ensure that social and economic power also tilts towards Bahujan. Instead, it might end up creating a small elite which gets co-opted and the same system reproduces itself. This is what has been happening with the linguistic question, with states reorganizing. Yes, some democratization will definitely happen. But the worry is that 90% we talk about in democracy still gets left out. So mera question therefore would be that we'll have to think. I don't think I would not agree if you say that question of neoliberalism, question of social content, question of Hindu social power is not linked to caste census. If we say this is an independent debate, jisko sirf yahan pe karke aap implement karo, my own understanding is in the long run BJP is also in favor. That's what the game they're playing. Idhar udhar karke shayad humko mil jayega, but they will do it in a way where social and economic power does not tilt. You might get representation, but you will get end up like neoliberal reforms milne ke baad, there is no difference between any political party. From left to Congress, today everybody favors a neoliberal order which is creating grave inequalities and informalization of labor. Similarly, tomorrow you will have a Hindu society where you might have the social power is consolidated. You might have different people speaking the same thing. So my question to you, as you know, those who are activists on the ground, you're mobilizing people, from a robust social power ka program and an economic program, ko kya isme jodne ka hai? Or is it that all of you are saying that these are two separate things, don't link these two things? Abhi to hum sirf caste census ka baat kar rahe. Let us go ahead with this one step and later think of the other bigger things, because they are not very feasible, or you don't see any direct link between these two. That could be. So let us go in a reverse order and ask Abdul to answer, then Sujata, and then Chandan.
Ajay sir, I think we need to differentiate between politics and electoral politics. So in electoral politics, you may have your own permutation and combinations, because you want to address your constituency. You want to enlarge your support base or vote base so that you can form the government, etc. So we need to differentiate between politics and the electoral politics. And for me, politics is not a bad thing, because it is the politics through which we can better our future. So as far as my point of view is concerned, I think representation do matters. Because when I go to higher judiciary, suppose I become judge of the Supreme Court, it is not only a member from the minority community is going, but my whole social upbringing, my whole ideology is going to the Supreme Court. So my sitting in a bench will make a difference, because I may give a dissenting opinion. I may not go with the majority, but it may happen that in the times to come, my dissenting opinion will become a majority opinion one day. But I will give my minority judgment or dissenting opinion. Why? Because it is not only Abdul who is going to the Supreme Court, but his whole background, his whole mentality, his whole ideology is going to the Supreme Court. And your upbringing matters when you give decisions. You cannot separate your decisions from your background. And that is why the question of representation becomes too important, even for ensuring justice or even ensuring the quality of justice. I do know that every decision which is coming from the Supreme Court do not qualify to be called as justice. But if I am there, at least I will try to minimize that difference between a judgment and the justice. So my representation matters a lot. You say that there are certain MPs, there are certain judges from the marginalized section that will not have too much impact. Yes, you may be right. But if we increase this representation, every walk of life, I am of the consider too that will make an impact. Zarur usse asar padega kahin na kahin decision. Aur dekhi decision making mein aaj aap nahi hain. Aapka matlab hai ki jo marginalized sections hain. आज आप मीडिया ले लीजिए, ओपिनियन मेकर है, लेकिन जो एडिटोरियल में है वो कौन लोग हैं? एक सर्वे हुआ था जिसमें ये पता लगा कि 90% कौन लोग हैं ओपिनियन मेकिंग में। जब आप ओपिनियन मेकिंग में नहीं होंगे तो किस तरह का एक नैरेटिव बनाया जाएगा, हम सब जानते हैं। ईडब्ल्यूएस के फेवर में किस तरह का नैरेटिव बनाया गया, और जो पहले से रिजर्वेशन चल रहा है उसको एंटी मेरिट नैरेटिव किस तरह से बनाया जाता है। आप कोई नहीं कह रहे कि ईडब्ल्यूएस रिजर्वेशन से मेरिट अफेक्ट होगा, लेकिन पहले वाले रिजर्वेशन से मेरिट अफेक्ट होगा ये हर कोई कहता था। ये नैरेटिव किसने बनाया? कौन लोग हैं वो जो इस नैरेटिव को बना रहे हैं? वो लोग जो मीडिया में बैठे हुए हैं, जिनका स्ट्रेंथ मीडिया में ज्यादा है। अमेरिका में ये प्रॉब्लम हुआ था, अमेरिका ने ब्लैक्स को मीडिया में लाना शुरू किया, उन्होंने अफर्मेटिव पॉलिसीज बनाई। हमारे इस तरह की कोई पॉलिसी नहीं। आप एंकर उठाकर देख लीजिए, अगर आप चार पैनलिस्ट हैं टीवी डिबेट में तो वो कौन लोग हैं? आपका पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू कैसे निकल कर आएगा? जुडिशरी में देख लीजिए, अभी कोई यहां पर डाटा दे रहा था कितने जजेस किस कम्युनिटीज हैं, ओबीसी का एक है, अभी विमेन का कोई जज नहीं था, अभी तीन बनाए गए, लेकिन उन तीन विमेन में कौन है, किस सेक्शन से हैं, ये भी देख लीजिए आप। तो जो डोमिनेंट सेक्शन है उसको आप डिसीजन मेकिंग में बैठा ले जा रहे हैं, तो बदलाव नहीं आएगा। बदलाव आएगा कि नॉन डोमिनेंट पोजिशन से आप लोग लेके बिठा लिए सेक्शन में, तब बदलाव आएगा। रिप्रेजेंटेशन एक या दो से नहीं होगा, हर सेक्शन में चाहिए, हर इंस्टीट्यूशन में चाहिए, तब मैं समझता हूँ कि कहीं ना कहीं जो है वो फर्क पड़ेगा। और फर्क पड़ेगा, जो आप क्वेश्चन ऑफ रिप्रेजेंटेशन बोल रहे हैं वो छोटा मोटा सवाल नहीं है, या क्वेश्चन ऑफ डिग्निटी जो है वो छोटा मोटा सवाल नहीं है। मैं कितना भी पढ़ लिख जाऊं लेकिन मुझे किन स्लर्स से बुलाया जाता है मैं जानता हूं। I am highly qualified, लेकिन मेरे गांव के लोग या मेरे आस पड़ोस के लोग मुझे किन नामों से बुलाते हैं वो मैं जानता हूं। तो ये जो डिग्निटी है ना, इसको आप कम मत समझिए। ये जो डिग्निटी आएगी वो मुझे लगता है कि रिप्रेजेंटेशन से आएगा, और रिप्रेजेंटेशन का सवाल बहुत जरूरी है। और मैंने पहले भी कहा कि मैं एज अ नागरिक, एज अ सिटीजन ऑफ इंडिया, ये जानना चाहता हूं कि कौन डिसएडवांटेज में है और किसको प्रिविलेजेस मिल रहे हैं। ये मैं समझता हूं कि बहुत बड़ा सवाल है कि सदियों से अगर आपको प्रिविलेजेस मिल रहे हैं तो आप दूसरे को भी दीजिए। क्यों आप तैयार नहीं, क्यों आप कहते हैं डिवीजन होगा? जब एससी एसटी सेंसस से डिवीजन नहीं हो सकता, जब रिलीजियस बेस पे सेंसस होता है उससे डिवीजन नहीं होता, तो ओबीसी काउंट से रिजर्व काउंट से जो है डिवीजन हो जाएगा। जब आप अभी संदर सर ने कहा कि 94% लोग अपनी ही कास्ट में शादी करते हैं, उससे डिवीजन नहीं होता। हम कास्ट नेम जो सरनेम है उसको पूरी थ्रू आउट लाइफ कैरी करते हैं, एक सोशल एक जो कैपिटल है उसको हम थ्रू आउट तक कैरी करते हैं, उससे सोशल डिवीजन नहीं आता है। हम जो है एडवर्टाइजमेंट हर पेपर में देख लीजिए, मैट्रिमोनियल एडवर्टाइजमेंट देखते हैं, रंग से लेकर हाइट से लेकर और उसकी कास्ट तक और रिलीजन तक, और रिलीजन में कौन सा सेक्ट है, शिया है या सुन्नी है, बरेलवी है या देवबंदी है, ये तक हमको चाहिए। तो समाज की सारी इनइक्वालिटी हम दबा कर बैठे हुए हैं, लेकिन एक चीज से इनइक्वालिटी बढ़ेगी ये चीज मैं कबूल नहीं कर सकता।
बिल्कुल, I think we are on basic agreement that. Sujata, you want to come in?
In India, caste is, I want to give an example that in Assam, Guwahati, sometime back, 4-5 years back, I was doing IAWS conference. I was coordinating caste and intersectionality, a topic which is given to the entire world, like papers have come. I just mentioned caste and intersectionality. 75 papers I received across the globe talking about Dalits. I didn't say Dalits and intersectionality. I said caste and intersectionality. So the moment caste comes in our mind, we think about the untouchability, who is the heinous, who is treated, ill-treated and all that. You are talking about social power and all. So in India, it is a very clear that this section of society is very much, you know, harassed by for everything, wearing a watch, going on a horse and everything. So especially that OBCs, when it comes to the power and the class and the distribution and reservation, they talk about it. But when it comes to the, you know, social side, they're not as bad as this section, right? You got my point, what I'm saying. So here, as I said earlier, let us count the census data, no problem. But in India, we combine the class, you know, economic status, it is very difficult. Because as Abdul said, even I'm a professor, I'm a principal, whatever, I don't get a house in Karimnagar because of my caste and my identity, right? So the class is nothing to do with in India. Right, whatever position you are into it. So there is no point when clubbing it. Right? So that is a different. And my problem is whenever we talk about the equality, dismantling this current political system, economic system, the onus is on Bahujans, not the privileged people who have been enjoying for ages. Right? So ye khali hamare upar thopke कि आप लोग क्या कर रहे हैं, बिकॉज आई सिट ऑन माई कंफर्टेबल पोजिशन, आई एंजॉय एवरी प्रिविलेज पोजिशन, तो आप लोग क्या कर रहे हैं, दैट्स व्हाट कांशीराम सेइंग, लेट अस रिवर्स द प्रिविलेजियस पोजिशंस एंड सी हाउ इट लुक्स। सो नाउ व्हाट आई हैव बीन सेइंग फॉर कपल ऑफ इयर्स, अरे ये कास्ट का तुम कितने रेप किया, मर्डर किया, ये किया, वो किया, छोड़ दो, लेट a literature come, experiences come from the privileged sections, how I enjoyed my privileges, right? Main itna judge kaise ban gaya, aisa karna, then we will have a real picture. So if you want to talk about the social reformation, social sector, then we have to work like this. If you want to talk about the economics, okay, Mayawati, as Abdul was saying, electoral politics are definitely different, but Bahujan philosophy is also different, right? So what we expect, Mayawati cannot do just electoral politics, but based on the Bahujan philosophy, because that is where the problem is coming. If everybody do electoral politics, then we don't need to have a Bahujan philosophy. Let us have because politics are politics, right? So as Ambedkar said, caste is an enclosed class. India is, it is not a different. Who are those capitalists in India? You know, you can select the caste, right? So let us not combine and confuse with these two things, right? Economics is nothing to do in India as long as you don't have in mind that I have to decastify myself. So when I was talking in America, somebody, Rohit Vemla, on Chowdhury fellow came in UMass, came that the title was caste discrimination in universities. He said, oh, she's insulting India because there is no caste discrimination in universities. A Chaudhary, he may not know what is a caste discrimination, right? Yeah. But he's right on his thing. But I know what is a caste discrimination in India. So we are in India. There is a privileged section. There is a section in the middle. There is a very vulnerable section. And to upside down and to talk about the economic equality, one particular thing se nahi hoga. Number one. As long as Ambedkar said, you turn any side anywhere and you see only the ghost is a caste, right? Until unless you dismantle the caste and you can't do any reformations. So if anybody is really clear about the economic equality, then they have to dismantle caste first, right? What Abdullah is saying is correct, that representation, we are in a political system that we have to deal with it. Now, overnight, you can't dismantle me. I am able to speak here, Abdullah is able to speak here because of the little bit of reservation we got from this existing system, and we are into the universities and we are talking about it. Otherwise, it is 90% Brahmins or whoever privileged sections they'll be occupying. So this representation is coming now from us because we are here, availing those existing opportunities. So this representation in existing system is very, very important. And dismantling and everything, doing big revolution, radical thing, we will give it to the privileged sections. ठीक है, तब तक हम लोग ऐसे झेलते रहेंगे. Yeah.
That's an interesting answer, Sujata. So you are in between, Kendan. So now you tell us, where are you on this question?
this fight is going on for last 5,000 years.
Yeah.
So, it keeps evolving. So it's in Gandhiji's methodology, struggle, truth, struggle.
Yeah.
So we keep crossing, like independence was not won in one moment. So we have to series of battle that needs to be fought at the ground. So yeah. You're right. Yes, everyone agrees ki representation is very important. It first gives you a sense of dignity. It gives you a sense of belongingness to the country, to the constitution, to the entire society. So that gives you a lot of confidence. That gives you, that's very important as a human. You, after all of us are human being. And then comes, you rightly said, the agenda that we're talking about is, according to you, the left of center economics is very important for the deprived and marginal section. So somewhere down the line, it's not we are compromising. The more the people, as Abdulji was saying, the institutional biasness will get over. If there is a lack of, if the idea of social diversity is there, if Abdulji is there, Sujata is there, you are there, and couple of more people from other social diverse background are there and discussing on policy making, I'm sure all those social contradictions will come under discussion over policy making. At presently, what is happening is that is not coming. That's why that is very important for any nation, for any nation building exercise, so that all of us are seen to be moving together. So obviously, 100 rupees mein sabko baantna hai. It has, we need to balance each other. So the struggle will always be on for a better society, for a brotherhood, for a social harmony, for a communal harmony. So all this thing is always an ongoing process. And agenda wise, yes, the more people will join, a more representative democracy will be there. I'm sure more of a social contradiction will be answered. I don't know whether it may take some time, some issues may, economic issues may take a back seat over representation that happens and politics. But to say that, I'll also look at Mayawati and Samajwadi party and major bahut sare partiyas Brahmin Sabha kar rahe. So I look it the other way around. I could have never imagined 10 years, 10 saal pehle ki Brahmin, there will be an outreach program for the Brahmins by these parties. So it's like some sort of a political assertion by the upper caste. Like in North India, I haven't seen any parties doing a Brahmin outreach program. So in that sense, now Samajwadi Party, BSP, in a sense of, because every vote is important, whether you're a Brahmin or a Dalit, that constitution has given to us. So in that sense, so as for your electoral arithmetic, every vote is important. So every party tries to form their social coalition irrespective of upper caste, backward caste, Dalit, Mahadalit. So they have their own, like BJP has their own social engineering, Samajwadi Party will have their own, Social Congress will have their own. So that is a different matter. But yes, the more people from subaltern background will keep coming, the more, as you rightly said, will definitely, there will be a left of center idea of economics will definitely be more visible, will be much more there to be seen in policy making, there to be seen in much more nationalization of especially the basic, which will improve upon our basic quality of life, as you rightly said, education, health, agriculture, and all these sectors will definitely take a beat. Like during the UPA rule, in the Congress and the other regional parties were there, left parties were there. You see many, I mean, the 10 years of UPA, you see many revolutionary right-based legislation. Right to education, right to forest, right to land, right to dignity of life. So all these things were very empowering legislation when people from the subaltern background and came and got together and parties, they have a more of a rural India upliftment. So the more people of, more democrat, more representative democracy is there, better policy making and better results you will able to see in as far as the social addressing the idea of social contradictions goes. But we need to keep and I remember few months back, the importance of representation is as such ki why you see ki the reservation based hearings in Supreme Court or any court gets you see 90% of the cases related to reservation goes against reservation ideas because of the I remember one sitting high court judge from Kerala, he went on a record by openly speaking against reservation, and it was all over there in the newspaper, sitting high court judge, and he praised his own community of being twice born and they're born to rule and all those things. He made a very, and how can you expect that a sitting judge of Kerala High Court, when he will sit over some reservation issue, he will give his identity biasness will not come into play, is very hard to believe. Mm-hmm. He has openly criticized. So one retired DGP from Bihar, he recently made a comment about his own identity of being a upper caste identity, how he is born to rule, how he is. So all these things while he was DGP, I'm sure that identity biasness would have been there in his mind. So that's why we need to address the issue of social diversity, which will help us in addressing the social contradiction that exists in society. As long as there is a caste, as long as we are from different identity, the contradiction will keeps coming up. We need to evolve, we need to balance, we need to collect data, and all these things is an ongoing process, and we need to struggle to achieve for a better and a better society for that matter. Thank you.
Thanks, Chandan, for that. I think lot of problem that the way we are stuck has come from consolidation of power at one end, the tiny minority of caste Hindus and their unchanging social attitudes. I think on that we all would agree. I think, but only point where we are trying to kind of find some finest balance is that you are arguing that diversity and representation is important. I think you would all agree on that. But my only caution would be that may not automatically translate into what you are calling left of center policies or undoing social power. I think we need to take a note of caution, as we need to take a note of caution, as Sujata and Abdul were saying, that simply having a large economic policy of equality also cannot address question of social discrimination. Within that economic mobility, people might still feel socially discriminated. Question of dignity may not be. So our challenge really, I mean, where Indian democracy is stuck is bringing these two things together. I think representation by itself, I would caution that you're all very enthusiastic, but on itself may not naturally tilt it towards a certain kind of a progressive economic redistribution. That is not history. Historical evidence does not show that that has happened easily. So I think we'll have to keep raising this question independently. As Suja said, that now it's responsibility of caste privileged groups. So we have to raise that question and see how we attach it with the question of repentance. That should not block the main point that many liberals in India, caste Hindu, liberal, progressive scholars do not understand, is that this agenda need not block legitimate demand for representation and dignity through caste census. I think that's one step. The concern where they are real is that it might sidestep. We'll have to bring that question. So I think we'll have to keep both these things. And Chandan has put it well that caste has its own mobility. Abdul emphasized question of, I think, dignity. That's a very important point that he made, that, you know, mere presence brings dignity and confidence to so many others who are watching. When you have your people from your own community speaking that agenda, as Sujat also said, today we are able to discuss it with such kind of fine micro detail, because we have such diversity here that we are able to see the same problem from a different angle. So I have learned a great deal. Arjun, we have already overshot. Do you want to, just to respect the audience, take one or two questions, then maybe pass on these questions in emails to the panelists if they wish to in touch? So we can have one or two questions. Ishita could kind of read out one or two questions so that the panelists can answer them, and then we can wind up.
Right, sir. So there are many comments and many.
We can take all. So just selectively,
yes.
Can we take important one or two for each? One question to each panelist, let's say.
Sir, I will pose one question only. Basically, me being an economist and impact and policy being the focus, I really wanted to ask to all the panelists, since because of the pandemic, the census is delayed. We do the preparation 1 year before, do house listing. So many of exercise, post-enumeration check and everything goes on. And we are already in, 2021. So that date is passed because we focused on March 2021. This is also something unprecedented. So do our panelists think that, like what happened in the last decade, we had socioeconomic caste census having the reference period as 2013, sort of MIS data, and because census comes under Office of RGI, Registrar General of India, and Ministry of Home Affairs, entirely different set of rules and laws there. Do you think the government will go and constitute some real-time database like SECC, which and will it be acceptable to all the parties politically? How do you see the way forward going ahead in this tough scenario? If we can touch this aspect and also your way forward in two minutes each. If you'd like to add anything, Ajay sir.
Yeah, I think that's a good question. If they want to kind of quickly reflect that way forward, obviously, I think, Arjun, we are really stuck. I mean, apart from the question of economic policy, I think where we have failed is that the conscience of upper caste Hindus in this country has remained completely untouched by this kind of massive social discrimination we have all around us. How do you do that? Gandhi tried in his own way, but I don't think we have succeeded. As long as caste Hindus, so one of the important things this caste census can do is that it can at least lay bare the bare facts before caste Hindus of how much disproportionate social privileges they have enjoyed all through. And then we will have, I think, more ethical, I don't know where political and social power is going to come for that, but at least an ethical discourse where you, caste Hindus can no longer argue for merit and things like that in an indiscriminate manner. So with that, I think has been our major failure. I don't know if Abdul and Sujata would like to address this. Will this in any way caste census help in pushing back caste Hindus to become little more self-reflective and accommodative? That is the question that we might, along with the question of economic policy that you're raising. So 1 minute each, and then we'll wind up.
Right.
So in the same order, we'll ask Abdul to go first, and then Sujata and Chandra.
I would say, yes, there are practical problems. But as far as OBC count is there, then I don't think that there would be operational difficulty, because as I said that, there is only the requirement of adding one column to it, because already we are counting SCs and STs. And we have a central list. So as far as identification of OBC from different state would not pose a serious threat, because if we conduct the OBC count on central list, that would be fine. So yes, I do agree with you that there are practical problems. And because of the pandemic and all. But still, as far as though I say that you know, all caste census should be done. But even if government agrees to OBC count, then it is very easy for them. There is no operational additional operational cost involved.
Yeah, Sujata.
Yeah. See, what way you conduct the data and how you do people, they don't matter. Doesn't matter to us. But whether first government should accept and agree, and then everything can go well. So VMIS data, this data, and we are not bothered. And I'm sure, and I'm saying that if, through statewide, if we can do, it is very easy because states are already doing, having a data for policies, and that can, I agree.
OBC bill has already given it to states to kind of collect it. And so in the one sense, it's a good move, I think, to lay responsibility where people can more directly question rather than having center, which is very difficult for the community. So in that sense, it's a good thing to give states the responsibility. So Chandan?
I guess where there is a will, there is a way. As Abdulji has rightly pointed out, the EWS bill was passed in 48 hours. So, where all interest converged and the bill was passed hurriedly, what amendment of the constitution without any credible data and other thing. So, as I said, there has to be intent. And I see if we can have an RC data in place with this modern age technology and the research and software, everything, I mean, it's very easy. But I'm sure once for and all, 1931, data hua tha, uske baad hum logo nahi kiya tha, and it should be done by credible organization so that the data which comes out is credible, comprehensive. When I say comprehensive, each and every person of this country should be counted along with their parameters, with jo aap pura socio-economic caste census of each and every individual, that not excluding anyone. It should be inclusive, all sorts of inclusive data. So for once for and all, there is no heartburn, there is no amnesty exist. I am better off. I know why I'm being thrown out, why I'm getting out of this policy. I'll be content with my life. So it is in the best interest for the nation building. It will create some sort of a brotherhood. It will create some sort of a social capital, which is in the interest and justice for each and every citizen of this country.
Yes, but I doubt, Chandan, if this government is serious of implementing EWS also. They are, you know, this government has only about gimmick. Even EWS, I don't think they are sincere. Associate professor and professors have EWS. How can there be EWS once you're an associate professor? So.
Ajay, I always say, no, in Lutyens, there is a lack of social diversity in policy making and policy execution. So bring out those diversity, census will happen in 2048 hours. So, you know, the people, those who are at the helm of the affairs, then, as I said, people from across ideological color or sections, they are on the same page on this idea. So that is where I'm saying. So once their intent is very clear and the government is very important. In 2011, I don't know what happened, what kind of data was some suggest ki this data is of only highlighting the names. It was being circulated. I don't know, nothing is official about it. But people, they say there are some bit of logistics problem, basically one caste is being known, some sub-caste ko kaise karenge and all those things. These are, I don't think, say these are only showing a lack of intent. If they can, the whole entire government can collect NRC data and collect all those papers, what stops? We have already done in 1931. You have to already carry it from there, and with a lot of technology, software and everything in place, I don't see it's an issue. It's a lack of intent, and people have to agree. As they're saying, there has to be a sense of agreement. I said, the ruling elite of this country is against OBC count. To the public intellectuals, so that intent, that hardly I see a lot of writings, and that is not there. So as long as so everything, then we will have some sort of here, though the other bottleneck. okay, we'll do it through rural development minister, and then you will say this rural development ministry was not the authorized agency to conduct a caste census. It's a registrar, as rightly pointed by Arjun, it's a registrar of census that conducts like in US, world over is decadal census is being conducted. US is done with. So what stops India from doing that? Are we lagging behind, or there is a, I mean, there is a total lack of intent from the entire ruling elites?
Yeah, I think that way your party made a good beginning in Punjab. I think that's a big, big change. Hope we move more and more.
Yeah, I mean, in that sense, there is no lack of intent from my party. I mean, I'm not just getting Congress. But yes, but what I said, ki my party has also to, I mean, you know, if 6 of us are supposed to take decisions, so 5 of disagree, then it will be very difficult for anyone to take decisions. So that is what is happening with the government of India decision making body. So there is a lack of total social diversity in decision making process at the key departments and the key positions.
So I once again thank all 3 of you for this wonderful interaction. And now over to Arjun for a formal vote of thanks.
Sir, Abdul sir wanted to make some point. Abdul sir?
Yeah, I want to make one clarification that Ajay sir was saying that EWS food, the government is not willing to implement it. It's already implemented and posts were filled, but they passed it in so hurry that they could not think that what will happen under certain categories, for example, associate professor. So if you provide EWS quota at associate professor stage, he will not be able to because his salary is so. So yeah. I think this was implemented or it was drafted in so much haste that they were more interested in, you know, the vote bank politics. They wanted to, you know, assuage the feeling of the upper caste sections. Because isse pehle wo roster system aaya tha, aapko yaad hoga, 13 point roster system aaya tha. जब ओबीसी सेक्शन ने थोड़ा सा प्रोटेस्ट किया तो उसको बदलना पड़ा और उसके मुकाबले में इनको ईडब्ल्यूएस रिजर्वेशन देना पड़ा तो बहुत हेस्ट में आया था और बहुत सारी यूनिवर्सिटी में अपॉइंटमेंट हुए और मैं आपके थोड़ा सा बताना चाहूंगा कि बहुत जगह जो इसका कट ऑफ है यानी जो मेरिट है वो ईडब्ल्यूएस की वो ओबीसी से नीचे है बहुत जगह
जेएनयू के एंट्रेंस में भी हो रहा है लगातार हमारा सेंटर में कुछ सेंटर्स में ओबीसी हैव बीन टॉपिंग द लिस्ट सो दैट इज हैपनिंग बट देन इट कट्स बोथ वेज. Once they top, then people say, why do they need reservation? If they don't do well, then they say, merit nahi hai, toh reservation. So the argument cuts both ways for caste in this.
Yeah, that's also gives you more reason to have a caste census based on that.
Hopefully, it would be fought through caste census. So thanks, and Arjun, yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. So let me just briefly, quickly, give the vote of thanks on behalf of IMPRI Center for Human Dignity and Development. I thank all of you for joining us today for the State of Human Dignity and Development hashtag Inclusive Development series. And today on the panel discussion on caste census, why the delay? We thank all of you for joining this very enriching deliberation today, so depthful. So we are very thankful to all of our panelists today for joining us today evening and sparing the time. Professor Sujata ma'am, Dr. Chandan sir, Abdul sir, and our moderator, Dr. Ajay Gunawarti sir, for making this so enriching, and we all learned a lot. So, and for all of the participants also here, and on Facebook, it has gone really wild. Many people reacting, thanks to Chandan sir. So thank you everyone for tuning in here today, and those who would be watching it later on YouTube or listen to or any of the podcast will also be coming with event report and what the outcome should look like. So thank you everyone for joining in, and I wish you a very good evening. Thank you. We hope.
Okay, thank you everyone. Arjun for taking up all these important issues regularly.
Thank you.
Thank you. Ajay.
Bye, Sujata. Nice.
Bye, Chandan. Bye, bye.
Thank you. Meet sometime.
Yes. Thank you, Sujata.
Yes. Thanks, Ajay.